Hello, everybody. Good afternoon, and thanks for coming. Or good morning. Is it afternoon yet? Yes, it is. Well, you know, today we're going to discuss allergies and how they affect your health. And when I was a resident and I was studying the immune system, allergy can affect all diseases, can mimic all diseases. So we have to pay attention to it, especially the food, because the food is critical to understand, along with other things. But, and of course, you need to know why do you get sick. And this is a disclaimer, of course, that we are required to tell you. I'm not an immunologist, but I've been doing immunology for 25, 30 years. And we've learned a lot of things along the way to pass on to you. So really, why are we sick? So I have two slides here that really tell the story. The picture, this was the president's report in 2008, 2009, and this is the reason we're so sick. So this is a post-industrial revolution event. This did not exist 150 years ago. So if you really want to get well, get rid of your diabetes and cancer and most diseases, you need a time machine, go back to 1700s, and then you'll be fine. Now this is also another important slide. It's not in your handout, but I wanted to show you these two slides. I put them on this morning. And there was a study, they took 10 cord blood from 10 infants, fully born infants. They took the cord blood throughout the United States and they studied it. And look what they found. We're all toxic. 287 toxins identified in the umbilical cord blood. 180 caused cancer. 217 caused toxic to the brain. And 208 caused birth defects. So really, from the get-go, we're in trouble. So this is the reason why we are in trouble. Now let's look specifically to the food allergies. Indoor and outdoor, you breathe environmentals and other things, but you're dealing with inhalants, you do chemicals and food. Now foods cross-react with different seasons, as we'll see. Right now the ragweed season is big, but we have throughout the year different trees and pollens and cross-react with the food. So are you really allergic to the food, or are you allergic to the trees or to the grasses that coexist at that time? So there may be a trigger. For example, ragweed season triggers with melons, doesn't agree with melons. So you always have a little bit of allergy to the ragweed all year round, but it's very low. When the ragweed season is way up here, then it exacerbates the problems in the foods that go with it. Then we look at the symptoms of food allergy versus cross-reactivity. Now, when you talk to traditional doctors, they're pollenologists. They look at pollen only. They don't think there's such thing as a food allergy. They say it's food reactivity. But we're playing with words here. At the end of the day, you're going to have symptoms, and the symptoms that you're going to have mimic allergy symptoms. So although we try to differentiate them, but again, food trigger environmental allergy symptoms. You have itching and you have tingling of your mouth and itchy tongue and the throat and the lips feel swollen. On the true side, you have cramping, hives, diarrhea, and pain. But as a practicality, as a patient, you have any of these symptoms, does it make any difference what it is? To me, it doesn't. You need to treat it. Now, how does this happen? The immune system mistakes the proteins in the food as pollens. So really, what causes the allergy is the protein that exists in different parts of trees and grasses and all that. So that's the problem. So apples contain proteins similar in structure to pollen, like birch pollen. So you're going to have reactivities. Now, Jolie was telling you earlier, if the protein is intact, how do you destroy proteins? With heat. So if you cook your food, the apples or whatever you want to cook, you can most likely destroy that reactivity. It's hard to cook watermelon. Okay. Why does this happen again? Usually only triggered by fresh food, not by cooked foods. Okay? So if you cook your food, if you steam them, then you are less likely, you reduce the overload. And so it may affect person with pollen-based allergies all year long, but it is intensified during a certain time of the year. So if you're sensitive to ragweed season, these are the foods that cross-react. We have bananas, cantaloupes, cucumbers, honeydew, watermelon, and raw zucchini. Also, you have chamomile tea, sunflower seeds, echinacea due to their belonging to the same botanical family. So these, if they belong to the same family, they cross-react with each other. If you're sensitive to grasses, melons, tomatoes, oranges, peaches, and celery cross-react during the grass season, and that's the spring, the midsummer season. So different times of the year, you have to avoid different foods, like in the spring, apples, cherries, peaches, pears, celery, parsley, almonds, and hazelnuts. So all these things, you try to avoid them or minimize them, I should say, during the season. Now, about 75, 80 years ago, if you went to an allergist, what he did elimination rotation diet. So what we need to do here, during this season, you may have the food maximum every 4 or 5 days, once a week. During the off season, you can have it more often. But ideally, a rotation elimination diet is great, no matter even if you're not allergic, because whatever enters your mouth takes 4 days to leave your body. So that's something to remember. So what can we do about this? You know, eat the right foods. And also, for the people that cannot get better with nutrition, with elimination rotation diets, we have a form of treatment called LDA, low dose antigen. This was invented in England. They call it EPD, enzyme potentiation desensitization in England. We changed the name in America because the FDA didn't like the name. And so, but it's the same thing. But there are many ways of doing this. You take the traditional people that give you shots once or twice a week. This form of treatment, you take shots every 2 months the first year, every 3 months the second year, once a season to every 6 months the third year. And this is the only form of treatment that I know that addresses inhalants, which is the pollens, foods that we all eat, and of course chemicals. So 90% correction rate for inhalants, 80% for foods, and 70% for chemicals. So it's really a great way to go. And if you hit a home run with this, all the allergies are gone. So really, that's a very nice way to go. So, you know, the questions, if you have questions, of course, I'm open to questions. But again, I want to say that no matter what disease you have, no matter what state of health you are, you should check to see if you're allergic. And many symptoms, if you have, for example, boys with long eyelashes, that's allergy. Yeah, earwax, excessive earwax, that's allergies.
Okay. With long eyelashes?
Yes.
It's an allergy.
Yes, usually. Pollens could be pollens, foods, or chemicals.
They get on their eyelashes, sir.
Well, their eyelashes are much longer. Usually, the moms brag about their little boys having such beautiful eyelashes. Yeah, that's an allergy.
It's much higher.
Yeah, I didn't realize that.
Yes, sir. Low dose antigen. It's a form of treatment, and what we use, you utilize enzymes with a homeopathic dose of inhalants, foods, and chemicals. Fabulous treatment. Okay. So that's what it stands for. But again, when you look at the dark circles under your eyes, it's chemicals and foods. Postnasal drainage, usually it's foods. GI problems, usually it's food. You have diarrhea, constipation, bloating, that's food or fungus. Usually the mold is in the winter. So you know, winter time when we eat all the candy for Christmas and all that, then you have the mold season. Yes, ma'am?
Is this a treatment that can be used on animals?
It can, but we cannot offer it here because we're not veterinarians. Yes. Yes, it can be used in animals. Foods usually. And then when I was doing, before I was doing alternative medicine, I was in ENT, and people that need more than one set of ventilation tubes for the kids, they got allergies. If one set of tubes doesn't take care of the problem, you must look for allergies.
Can sensitivity to food cause halitosis?
It can. Yeah, the question is, sensitivity can cause halitosis? It can, yes. Because you have fermentation issues.
So the four-day rotation diet, can that help?
It helps. The four-day rotation diet is good for everybody, even if you don't have allergies. Mm-hmm. So, again, when we, let's talk a little bit about the LDA. Let's assume that you have issues with allergies. The workup is, you know, you take a food history, and you also take a history of digestive system issues, and you have to correct the digestive system because, again, although the floor appears to be the food, and in today's world, seek or organic food as much as possible, and then if you do that, then eliminate one part out of it. Then you look at the digestive system, make sure you have to know that the digestive system has 200 species and 200 trillion bacteria that live in the gut, and the good guys are there to protect you, to protect the immune system, and also they are there to digest food and to give you vitamins that you cannot digest yourself. However, the greatest majority of these beneficial bacteria populate the gut. When you get sick, you have this upside down thing happening, and your yeast and other things happen in your digestive system. They must be corrected before you do the allergy correction, because you'll never correct the allergies unless you correct the digestive system. Also, another thing to remember, you have to correct the adrenals. The adrenals kind of tie it in to the immune system as well. You have to correct the adrenals and the thyroid. You have a question?
My question is, like, with hypertension, there's too much sodium, but there's a lot of food additives that have sodium in it. I mean, could that be allergies?
It's not the sodium only.
Yeah, right.
If you have hypertension, you look and see what other, because remember what I said in the beginning of the lecture, that allergies can mimic all diseases. So if you have, let's say, hypertension, it would behoove you to see if you have any allergies and work with the digestive system, the immune, and also the endocrine system and the thyroid.
If a person came to you, would you do a complete blood screen of every imaginable?
You don't have to. That says you could, but it's expensive. So you just need to do just a few inhalants and a few foods and a few chemicals, and you get the answer. Because the way we treat people in this clinic is with the LDA. The LDA covers the whole spectrum.
What is LDA?
Low dose antigen. It's an enzyme, combination of enzyme and homeopathic dilutions of inhalants, foods, and chemicals. You take three shots for that. Yes. Yeah, that's chemicals. It's the chemicals in the air. And of course, yeah, the chemicals that trigger other things. So when you have the allergies, you can be triggered by food, but it can be triggered by chemicals. So if people have chemical allergies, now at 2,200 feet above sea level, the pollution stops. So move to Denver. Okay.
I lived in Denver for 7 years. I was great there.
Yeah. There you go.
Thank you.
Whatever enters your mouth, the body takes 4 days to eliminate it from your body, to kick it out.
Okay.
So if, let's say, you're allergic to apples, and if you eat them once a week, then you're going to have problems for the first 48 hours, and then give your immune system a break for the next 3-4 days. Mm-hmm. But if you eat them every day, you have a cumulative effect. You never get rid of it.
So even though you're regular, you're having, regular.
Doesn't matter. Yeah, whatever enters your mouth takes 4 days to leave your body, even if you're healthy. You had a question back there, sir? Yeah. So, yes, ma'am?
Can you expand on the long eyelashes of boys?
this is medicine, is a science and an art. The art of medicine is your observations. For example, you look at the face, they call it allergic facies. You have a line in your nose, and you clean your nose all the time like this. You can develop a crease in your nose that's called the allergic salute. That's allergies. When you have long eyelashes, that's allergies. When you have the dark circles on your eyes, that's allergies. When you have the postnasal drainage, which is all the time, you have allergies until proven otherwise. These are clinical observations. Okay. Well, let's see, what else can we talk about?
Well, what about some other ways to sort of, you know, kind of along the lines of helping the immune system adapt, so it's not having this huge reaction to allergies? What can we do to help this whole adaptogenic?
Well, how can you help to adapt to the allergies is the question, okay? So, you know, one of the ways you always start when you're stuck and you don't know what to do, you always go to the digestive system and the endocrine system. The digestive system cannot be corrected. The adrenals cannot be corrected unless you correct the digestive system. And then, but you go one step below and you want to see, you know, what can you do about the digestive system and with the food. And as we saw, let me go back to the initial slide here. How we start over. Let's see, slideshow. If I can find it. Yeah, no, I need to go back to the beginning. Why don't you go back to the beginning? Because you go back to the two slides in the beginning, that says it all. Well, I'm electronically challenged, but nevertheless, if you remember.
We've had our engineers checking it, and the bottom line is it's toast.
Okay. Basically, if you remember the two slides in the beginning, the president's report, and then we do the cord blood, they have the toxins in it. That is the problem. So where do the toxins come from? You breathe them, you eat them, and you drink them. So you have to avoid those three things. Well, if you stop breathing, eating, and drinking, you know, obviously you can't function. But again, if we go back in time a couple hundred years, we'll see that those things were rare. Hippocrates, 2,500 years ago, talked about this also. But it was extremely rare. Cancer was extremely rare. Hypertension, diabetes, all things were extremely rare. Infections were rampant because we didn't have. So really, if you look, who deserves the longevity that we have these years? Who really deserves it? Are the doctors, the scientists, or the plumbers? The plumbers deserve the longevity because they give us clean water. So I would like to say the doctors, but the plumbers deserve most of the credit. Yes, sir?
How does the GMOs, without getting into processed food and stuff, but just basic GMOs or corn affect the allergies?
Okay. All right. Now, the question is how the GMOs affect the immune system. Because we're talking about the immune system here. We need to understand that the body has functions on two principles. On one side, we have biochemistry, and the other side, we have biophysics. Now, the way Mother Nature or God created us is what holds the foods together is carbons, like a chain. But the chain cannot be more than 50 carbons long. Now, along comes the GMOs and the chemicals, and they have chains. For example, this bottle here probably has this cap here, about 2,000 carbons to put it together. The problem with the fake stuff, the man-made stuff, is it cannot hold electricity. What would happen in this building if I shut off the electricity? It wouldn't be so comfortable. And after 3 days, you won't be able to move in here. Okay, so you're destroying the battery in the car. You destroy the electric system in the car, same thing. So all these GMO foods cannot hold a charge. Normally, a charge in the cell is minus 70 millivolts. But when you incorporate fake foods into the chain, into the cell wall, they lose the charge. So minus 70 is healthy, minus 40, 50 is like chronic fatigue, fibromyalgia, minus 10, minus 20 is cancer. So you drop. When you drop your voltage, then the enzymes quit working, everything quits working. So you gotta have, I'm gonna play piano, I need both of my hands. You take one hand away, I might still be good, but not as good. So you need to have both sides.
How long are there carbons, do you know, like in the GMO fruit?
More than 50.
More than 50.
Yes, I don't know how many, but everything.
What was the question?
The question is how many carbons in the GMO foods? More than 50.
Is it true that all wheat is contaminated, even the organic one, because of cross-contamination?
Yeah, well, the question is how GMOs contaminate, cross-contaminate other foods. They can. And wheat, of course, it has been altered so many times genetically. It's not the original wheat that used to be
so
2,000 years ago.
The organic,
it's better, much better, but not as good as 200 years ago.
Well,
yes.
Even still, the soil that the wheat is grown in is no longer
well,
the same.
Well, we know as of 1933, this is according to America, to the American Department of Agriculture, all the soil that we grow food in America is depleted for minerals, all of it. 1933. All the soil that we grow food in America is being depleted since 1933. So what they put lots of nitrogen on to make it green, to make it beautiful, to grow fast. They did a study of Texas A&M did the study. They took the same people, the same scientists, took a plot of land. They planted cabbage on one hand, which was organic. In the same area on the other side, it was commercial. And they grew the cabbage, and they wanted to extract the vitamin C by the pound. By the pound, this side had much more by the pound to give you, not vitamin C, but just pounds, less than the other side. But by the pound, vitamin C was 60 to 100 times more present in the organic than in the non-organic. So we know that you gotta have, if you leave things alone, Mother Nature alone, knows what to do. And the way we're doing it is just everything's about profit, instead of so. The other bad thing that happens in America, 99% of the foods, the meals that we have, is not a nutritious event; is a social event. We get together. I remember I had a patient from Iowa. And he wanted to lose weight. He was like 500 pounds. Came in, and he lost 250. He lost half his weight. He went back home. His family rejected him because you don't eat like us anymore. Get out of here. So he started eating again to be accepted. Yeah. You had a question?
My question is like greens is like a natural detoxification of the liver. So if people eat more greens, do you think that they have less allergies? Or
well, the question is about is the greens better than the meats and others. When we look, generally speaking, that's it's not 100% rule. All the plant kingdom is alkaline, and all the acid kingdom is acid. So what causes disease is acid. Yeah. So you try to keep your pH close to 7, saliva pH over 7, you're in good shape. Most people, if I were to test most Americans, the saliva pH would be like 6.5. Okay? So really, at 7 and above, that's when you get healthy.
Do you promote a vegan diet?
Do I promote a vegan diet?
A healthy vegan diet?
Healthy, but you have to be balanced. What you're missing with a vegan diet is some of the amino acids. And what we do, I agree with the vegans, but I see them to be, in the long run, they get sick. So what they need to do is you need to supplement amino acids. Now, there are a couple of different companies that make pure amino acids, no GMOs, nothing, pure, great. There are a couple of companies we carry their products. And really, if you take that, the Italians did a study. They put people on a strict vegan diet, and they gave them, they call it MAP in Italy, MAP, most master amino acid profile. And they put them on the MAP and the strict vegan. And they found out 6 months later, the people that were doing that compared to the control study, they did so much better muscle tone, much healthier. So you do need your protein. Because when you look at the food pyramid, and it's in my book, it shows you 70% is water, 20% is protein, and 10% is everything else. So really, water is probably the most important thing, and protein is the second most important. The fats would be the third, and the minerals the fourth. The carbs is the least important, but you still need them. You need to have complex carbs.
What about dairy in the diet?
They taste good.
Yeah. You have to try those
dairy in the diet.
How do you get your calcium without dairy?
No, no. You want to have
so
calcium,
you
peppers.
What do you think about dairy?
I think it tastes good,
yeah.
But I like it just like everybody. But let me tell you this: the studies have shown that osteoporosis, milk and milk products cause osteoporosis. They don't prevent it.
Yeah.
So you need to get your minerals someplace else. Now, 1933, the American Dairy Association decided to come up with the four food groups, which are fake, okay, because they put food milk as a by itself. So if you look biochemistry 101, basic science here, undeniable science, the three food groups, proteins or amino acids, lipids or fats, carbohydrates or sugars. Three, not four. Okay, the three. Now then, if you want to be healthy, you're going to divide them either immunosupportive or immunosuppressive. Are they pro-inflammatory, anti-inflammatory? So you got to eat foods that are immunosupportive and anti-inflammatory. You look at milk, it has all three. It has protein, fat, and sugar in it. They're all pro-inflammatory and immunosuppressive. Now, the only milk that is not immunosuppressive and pro-inflammatory is human milk. Okay?
What?
Human milk. Good for cow milk is good for cows, not for people. But it tastes good. And I'm not going to lie to you. I eat ice cream once in a while too. Yeah. But that's not what you're supposed to do.
Is it a raw milk better to give a child rather than a person like a low fat?
Yes,
raw. No fat.
You see, the problem with the allergies is in the protein. So when you have skim milk, it's worse than whole milk for allergies because there's protein in it. Okay. However, the question is, raw milk is better than pasteurized milk. This is yes, but you're running two risks, one with Lyme's and one with tularemia. There are a couple bugs. And then, of course, how you harvest the milk, they found in raw milk, 6% is pus. How's that? When they milk the cows, they're not, you know, they just, so they pasteurize them.
I don't drink milk either, but I
so you see what I'm saying? You got three things. Pasteurization prevents you from infections, but then it's not, it tastes like milk, looks like milk, but really isn't.
And it doesn't contain some of the things that raw milk do that are good for you.
Yes, of course. You destroy all the enzymes and other things, yes. If you have your own cow, you milk your own cow, and it's clean, that's okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, back to the vegetables. How is ozone washed to your vegetables? Does that help with the allergies? Is it just the pesticides?
Okay. Let's talk about washing the vegetables. Now, I tell this to all my patients. Let's assume I'm a farmer in South Texas, and I'm an ethical farmer, and I grow organic food, well, with other rules and regulations, and then. Mr. Jones comes to pick up the fruit from South Texas to bring it to Dallas-Fort Worth. Now, Mr. Jones is a businessman. He can't afford to have his fruit and vegetables go rotten, can he? He's going to lose a lot of money. He paid me cash. I got my money, and he left. So he's got to come to Dallas-Fort Worth now and sell it to you, okay, to reach your kitchen. You know what he's going to do? As soon as he leaves my farm, he's going to spray them. To prevent spoilage. So when it comes to you, it's this organic farms from Dr. Kotsanis. Okay. So here's what you need to do: take the vegetables, take all the fruits, put them in the sink in the kitchen, fill it up with water, put a cup and a half of peroxide, okay, and then leave it there for a half an hour, shake it a couple times, and then drain it. Fill it up with water again, put a cup and a half of apple cider vinegar for another 15, 20 minutes, shake it a couple of times, rinse it. Now you remove the surface chemicals that Mr. Jones put on the fruit, and also you killed all the parasites. So that's the way to prepare your vegetables anyway. Okay? Everything, fruits, vegetables, everything.
You said white apple cider vinegar or white vinegar?
Apple cider vinegar. Yes, sir. 15, 20 minutes.
3%
I'm sorry?
3%, that's what we get at the store.
That's good. Now, if you want to get really crazy, you put the 35% peroxide, which is food grade, but it will burn your hand, so stay out of it.
Do you mix it with water?
Just water. You fill it up with water and just put a cup and a half of peroxide in the tub.
In a clean sink.
Yes, of course.
How much apple cider vinegar?
A cup and a half. Yes.
They both sit for 15, 20 minutes?
Sure. Half an hour the first time, 15 minutes the second time.
So you don't believe in the ozone method, using O3?
The thing is, you use ozone, but you have to have medical grade ozone.
You have what?
You have to have medical grade ozone to do this.
Oh, so that's
ozone. Very expensive, and you know, you're talking about a machine that costs $5,000 to clean your fruit. That's good. But. You know, I mean, the ozone that they, the so-called ozonators that they clean the rooms and all that, they're okay, I guess, but it's cheaper to do it the other way, because we know the peroxide and the apple cider vinegar works better. Maybe what you're saying is okay, but very difficult, because you have to encase it in a bag, and you've got to pump in the gas for 20, 30 minutes. You can't breathe it, so you may get lung problems trying to clean your fruit. It's not a good idea. Yes. Yes, sir.
I read that in Russia, they use peroxide on milk, so it will not spoil. It will go bad.
Oh, huh. Yeah, well, it's okay. Yeah. Yes.
Is hydrogen peroxide the same as peroxide?
Yes.
The kind you clean your hands?
Yes, ma'am. It's the same thing.
Kind of along the bacteria thing a little bit. I recently read an article that the CDC did finally say that we're at the end of the antibiotic era. Superbugs are going to gain some, quite a bit of...
We can't destroy them with antibiotics anymore because
right.
they know what we're doing to them.
Yeah.
So the only thing we go back before penicillin, in the peroxide, hydrochloric acid, and ozone kills them, and also colloidal silver. So these they cannot mutate against, especially with ozone and oxygen. The bacteria cannot, all the bugs cannot mutate against oxygen.
And you said colloidal silver and something else.
Colloidal silver, ozone, hydrochloric acid, and peroxide. Four things. You had a question?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yes. Go ahead.
Did you say there's a connection between dairy and limes?
Well, if you eat raw milk, if the goat has limes, the milk has limes.
Whoa.
Okay. Yes.
What about eczema and rashes? Is that more committed to your digestive?
Eczema and rashes. Eczema and rashes is a form of allergy, but it's a severe allergy.
Okay.
Like asthma is a severe allergy. Connected primarily to your liver.
Mm-hmm. So is there a way to test things to see if they
yes.
like raw milk? Can you test them for limes, or can you test them for?
I'm sure there's a lab out there to do this, but you know you're talking about a gazillion dollars to do it, so.
Just don't drink it.
Yes, sir.
What do you suggest in terms of drinking water? What kind?
Water has to be filtered. Okay. Another thing that I, you know, there are many filters and they're all good, and you know, alkaline water, you know, depending who you talk to, but it has to be as an ORP and negative ORP, oxidation reduction potential, and also bilayer alkaline. The other thing that I discovered the other day, because I talked to a lot of science around the world, this guy's a PhD chemist, and he says, what's the cause of Alzheimer's? And he says, Alzheimer's is because of the water we drink from the municipalities. And I said, how about, I have a filter. No. He said, once in solution, you put salt in here. It's a solution. You cannot filter the water out. Okay? You can't. I mean, the salt out. So he recommends, he tells me, that all the municipalities, when they clean the water and they put all kinds of chemicals in it to send it to your home with less infection, they boil it, they raise the temperature to like 70, 80 degrees. But if they were to boil it, all the contaminants will precipitate. So he says, ideally speaking, no matter what the source of water is, filter it first, what you're going to do, then you bring it to a boiling point for 5 minutes, then they change the chemical composition or the precipitants, they precipitate out. Or even if you drink the precipitants with it, you may be able to see it or not,
so
they will not get absorbed.
Is good, then?
It's okay to do it. You have some kind of filtration system. But again, what he was telling me, if you take any water and you boil it for 5 minutes, you will precipitate out 98% of all the harmful things that eventually will precipitate in your brain, in your heart, and organs. So I have to, I told him to send me the articles. I don't have the articles yet. Yes, ma'am? Absolutely, yes, ma'am. Because of the surface chemicals and the parasites. Yes?
Give me 1 minute.
Sure.
Well, all right, so You're pretty much saying distilled water, which I've heard.
No, no, distilled water. No. Filtered water.
Filtered water has inorganic material in it.
But you can always take minerals as a supplement.
But you can add them.
You can add the minerals in it afterwards.
Well, so the next question was, do we absorb our minerals more from food, or do we absorb minerals from the water? Because a lot of people say you can't absorb those minerals in water.
Well, if they're chelated, in a chelate form, you can absorb them. The best way to get them from food, make a nice soup with everything in it, the kitchen sink in the pot, and boil them, and then get your minerals out. That's the best way to get them.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. For 3 days. If you go according to McEwen, who pretty much invented this, called EPD, nobody's going to do it. I did McEwen's program for about a couple of years, and I had to pull every hair out of my head, despite that I didn't have much left, and I quit doing it, because people will not do that. But 3 days I request. The day before the shot, the day of the shot, and the day after the shot, you have to be very strict. 3 days of boring diet, and then a week before and a week after, no fish oil. So that's
even after?
Oh my God.
Ideally.
Because I got the LDA yesterday, and today I started fish oil.
That's okay. Wow. It's okay. It's not a
crisis. It's not listed in your thing you would give out, so you want to check that one out.
I think it is.
Is it fish oil? I thought that was the week before.
Week before and after. Ideally speaking. Yes, ma'am.
What about juicing? There's a big thing about juicing all the raw things.
Well, the thing is with juice, and I like the blenderized form better, because you have fibers and other things in it, phytochemicals that you remove if you do the juicing, they take all the juice out. Well, it depends what you're trying to do, but my belief is you leave things alone, just break them up, put them in a blenderizer and drink them. I think that's better.
Make sure you clean them. Like
yeah, of course, clean them and blenderize them and take enzymes with them. But they have, if they're raw, they have plenty of enzymes. Yes, question?
What's ventilizing? You said clean them and then do what?
Blend them.
Blenderize. All right, gotcha.
You were saying colloidal silver is good for something. What is colloidal silver?
Colloidal silver is a great antibiotic. It kills viruses, bacteria, and fungi.
What's the parts per million that must be present?
One in 30 million, I think.
A lot of them say like 10 parts per million. No, it's 30 parts per million.
Something like 30 parts. 30 parts.
Like what you want to look for.
Yeah, it has to be done correctly. The AMA is advertising colloidal silver as being bad. They have this guy that is blue. You know, have you seen him? You all seen him?
Right.
But he was doing moonshine colloidal silver. He was making his own. Cool. If you do that, you know, there's no cure for ignorance. Okay.
Are all antivirals as well?
The hydrochloric acid is antibacterial primarily.
Not a viral, okay.
The hydrochloric acid, the peroxide is antiviral. And the colloidal silver is everything. And the ozone is everything.
If you were to kind of recommend, say, like 3 supplements, because we don't get so much in our food with the minerals and the vitamins and minerals that we need, what would be your
top three vitamin minerals? Good fish oil. Okay, then you have the good multivitamin, a good multivitamin mineral, and a good digestive enzyme X4. And don't forget vitamin D by its own. Yes?
What do you suggest as a detox plan?
Move back to 1700s. What we need to do is to eat primarily alkaline foods, alkaline pH, clean water, deep breathing, vitamin D. And of course, support with homeopathics the liver, kidneys, and lungs, and skin. That would be the best way to do it. It's gentle homeopathy is a gentle form of detoxification. Yes, ma'am.
What about chelation?
Chelation is a form of treatment which removes toxic metals. And again, you remember what I said earlier, we have two sides of the equation. We have the enzymes on this side and the electricity on the other side. Now, chelation works on this side of the equation primarily by removing the toxic metals. Now, the toxic metals, let's say mercury, for example, which is very rampant these days. you know, for, especially if you live in San Francisco, a week after they leave the factories from China, ends up inside 30% of it dumps in San Francisco. Okay? We know that. So what they do, they love to jump on the enzymes. They have an affinity to enzymes. Enzymes are special proteins. They have affinity to fat and affinity to enzymes. Now remember that your central nervous system, the nerves, etc., is primarily fat, good fat, but fat. Okay, not fat you have in your belly, but the fat up here, it better be good, otherwise you won't be able to think, talk, walk, or do anything. So they like fat and they like enzymes. So you need to remove them, okay? And if you remove the chelation, we remove from the soft tissues. Now what happens, everybody in this room and everybody in this world is toxic. To completely chelate them out from all the heavy metals from the body, it takes 1,000 years. It takes about 6 months to a year to take out of the soft tissues, but the bones are always toxic. And we know in chemistry, things move from high concentration to low concentration. So you do the chelation and you check every couple, 3 months to see where you're at. And let's say the load is from here, came all the way down here. You say, I'm done. No, you're not. You have to take chelation by mouth as a preventive for the rest of your life because you're going to reaccumulate. No, dialysis. No, I hope you don't. Dialysis happens when you destroy the kidneys. No, you don't want to go there. That's why whoever does chelation, they better be careful. As a matter of fact, I have a patient in this clinic. There was a young patient. It was given chelation every week without checking anything. In Arizona, I think it was. And the patient lost her kidneys. You can't do this. You better. Chelation in alternative medicine is like brain surgery in traditional medicine. You better know what you're doing. Okay? Yes.
What is the pills? Is this like chloroform or what is
this? Chlorella is a botanical that is gentle. You don't have to check the kidneys, you have to check anything. That's a gentle, takes forever. But you prepare somebody, let's say you want to clean up your mouth because you have a lot of dead teeth and all that, you take the chlorella before you see the dentist to have some absorption from the guts, remove some, it's a gentle form. Also other minerals also chelate as well, but they take forever. Vitamin C chelates. But you get forever. So if somebody's ill, you got to chelate quicker. If you're in quick chelation, it's IV form or pill form. But you have to be under the supervision of a physician that understands chelation.
Is that covered by insurance?
Some do and some don't. Yes?
What are your thoughts on food grade DE?
Grade DE, I'm not...
Dimatrix Earth?
Oh, yeah. I've seen those, and they're supposed to clean up the digestive system. And I don't have much experience with them, but I've seen in the literature.
These
are special things you do that you ingest to clean your gut. Yes? Time? Okay, yes.
Back to the issue for a moment. IV, DMPS, do you do any of that?
Yes, we do all of it. Actually, the best way to chelate, to combine oxidative therapy, it was Keystone. You do the oxidative therapy, and then on the back end of it, you give the chelation. It has a much more kick. Okay, well, thank you for coming. Enjoy talking to you.